Ball dominates bat on day one at Grace Road. Division 2 champions Lancashire are untouchable at the top of the table, and their goal this week against Leicestershire is to preserve their unbeaten record for the season. Lancashire come into this fixture after a home victory against Middlesex, whereas the Foxes enter the final game after a defeat away at promotion chase in Glamorgan. With the toss uncontested, Lancashire elected to field first, and it looked to be an excellent decision as they struck early. Firstly, the captain of the home side, Paul Horton, was caught by Keaton Jennings off the bowling of Richard Gleeson without scoring. And then Hassan Azad was caught and bowled, also by Gleeson, the hosts now 9 for 2. A third fell soon after, Colin Ackerman caught by Livingston off Richard Gleeson for a duck, the score 16 for 3. Rhodes would help to settle things down with some shots to the boundary to get the scoreboard going in the right direction, and the score would move past the 50 mark. But then the fourth wicket, Cosgrove the man out, bowled by Bailey for 17. And with that, it was lunch, the score 81 for 4. And in the afternoon, the wickets kept tumbling. Rhodes bowled by Gleeson for 43. And in his next over, Gleeson completed his fifer as he bowled Swindles for a duck. Leicestershire 6 down, but they would soon move their score past 100 with Dearden and Parkinson out in the middle. But with Dearden looking set on 30 runs, he was then out, Parkinson the bowler to strike. Then Mike and Callum Parkinson would look to steady the ship, but only a few overs later, Livingston was celebrating his first wicket as Mike was caught, Leicestershire 8 down as T arrived. Lancashire wrapped up the innings quickly in the evening session, as first Matt Parkinson trapped his brother Callum in front for 29 runs. And the innings was done and dusted as Gleeson notched his 6th wicket, Klein bowled for 3, Leicestershire all out for 155 runs. And the Lancashire response got off to a shaky start, as Keaton Jennings was gone with the very first ball of the innings, bowled by Chris Wright. 2 more overs were possible before bad light halted play at Grace Road, and the players wouldn't return to the field with stumps called early. Champions Lancashire are on top in this one. Despite that loss of England opener Keaton Jennings for a first ball duck, they'll be looking for bright skies and early runs tomorrow. Leicestershire finished day 3 with narrow lead over champions. The weather gods have had a big part to play in county championship matches all around the country, and Leicestershire versus Lancashire has been no different. No play was possible on day 2, and things weren't looking hopeful on the morning of day 3 as the rain had persisted overnight. There was no play possible before lunch at Grace Road, but it was better news in the afternoon as the umpires announced a 2 p.m. start to proceedings. A reminder of the match situation: Leicestershire have already completed their first innings, 155 all out. Lancashire have scored 2 runs in reply, but have lost the wicket of Keaton Jennings. And despite a couple of early boundaries, it didn't take long for Lancashire to lose their second wicket. Alex Davies was caught by Ackerman off the bowling of Klein for 9 runs. That brought Liam Livingston to the crease, and he started on the front foot as he fired 2 boundaries in 1 Chris Wright over. But the fun didn't last long, as he was then sent packing by Ben Mike, caught behind by Swindles. Rob Jones and Josh Bohannon would take the Lancashire score past 50, but it was a shaky batting performance from the champions so far. And the wickets kept coming, Lancashire 4 down as Jones was bowled by Mike. Bohannon went shortly after, Ben Mike picking up his 3rd wicket of the innings, the catch by Horton. Vilas hit a couple of boundaries in a quick and breezy innings, as he would make 18 runs off 10 balls before becoming the next man out, bowled by Klein. And then Bailey became the 7th Lancashire wicket to fall, Chris Wright picking up his 2nd wicket. Shortly after that, it was time for tea, with the score 105 for 7. A good session for Leicestershire, who picked up 6 wickets, including a spell of 3 for 22 by Ben Mike. 33 overs left today, with the Red Rose County trailing by 50. And Lancashire were looking comfortable in the evening session, Liam Hurt and Stephen Croft well settled and finding consistent boundaries to keep the score ticking along nicely. This pairing would take the score past 150, but shortly after that the 8th wicket would fall, Croft caught by Horton off the bowling of Klein for 44. But then the day's highlight, Callum Parkinson trapping brother Matt LBW the day after Matt did the same to him. What goes around comes around. Callum Parkinson would then wrap up the innings as he took the wickets of Liam Hurt. Lancashire all out for 170, leading by 15 runs. Leicestershire would have a period of the evening to safely engineer their way through, and the opening pair started on the front foot, with Horton in particular batting with intent. Horton, along with Assad, raced the score onto 40 for no loss, before the umpires decided that bad light would spell the end of the day shortly after 6 p.m. Fingers crossed for bright conditions on day 4, as this match could still go either way. Assad stars as Leicestershire hold Lancashire to a draw. There was nothing but pride to play for in the battle between top and bottom in Division 2, but wooden spoon winners Leicestershire will have been happy that they've given as good as they've got against champions Lancashire when play has been possible over the first 3 days. They'll resume on the final day 40 without loss as they look to perhaps set a target and give themselves an outside chance of winning the game. Play was able to get underway at 11:30, but things started badly for Leicestershire as with the fourth ball of the day, Richard Gleeson beat Horton with pace and swing to uproot his stumps. New batsman Colin Ackerman began in typically belligerent fashion as he sent his first ball to the square leg fence. Ackerman was motoring at better than a runner ball as a drive through the covers and a glance down to fine leg off Bahanan brought him more boundaries. And lunch arrived after an hour of play, with Leicestershire well placed on 94 for 1, with a lead of 79, having recovered well from the early loss of Horton. Leicestershire moved past 100 as the afternoon session began, and an Azad pull through square leg took the lead past 100 as well soon after. And three more boundaries off Hurt took Azad to his 8th 50 of the season. Ackerman had been quiet since lunch, but he announced his intent with 2 fours off Gleeson, but the paceman got his man from the very next ball as Ackerman was squared up and edged through to the keeper. Mark Cosgrove was the new batsman, but he didn't last long before he too fell to Gleeson as he edged a loose drive to slip. Azad remained, but the run rate slowed as the wickets checked Leicestershire's momentum. He saw his side to tee on 80 not out, with his side 181 for 3 and the draw looking increasingly certain with just one session of the season left. Leicestershire were able to add 10 more runs after tee before the heavens opened at Grace Road and brought the season to a close, with Azad unable to complete his century and finishing on 83. The hosts will be happy with the fight they showed to end the season, but will ultimately be very unhappy to finish bottom of the division, while Lancashire look forward to Division 1 cricket next season after finishing unbeaten and a thumping 45 points ahead of their nearest rivals. Watling holds up promotion chasing Glamorgan at the Riverside. Defeat against Northants last week ended any chance of promotion for Durham, but opponents Glamorgan still retain hope after crushing Leicestershire last time out. They'll need a big win at the Riverside and hope one of the two sides above them, Gloucestershire and Northants, fall to a heavy defeat as they meet each other in Bristol. Poor weather delayed the start at the Riverside, but Glamorgan looked to make up for lost time with a fast start as Hogan trapped Cameron Steele in front in the third over. Alex Lees hit back with early boundaries off Carey and Hogan. But Angus Robson came and went as he edged Carey to Brathwaite at slip. Lees responded with 2 fours from a Van der Hoogten over. And new signing BJ Watling joined him with some early boundaries as Durham steadied the ship to reach lunch at 75 for 2. The pair looked to be taking their side to 3 figures as the afternoon session began and the partnership reached 50. But Hogan got one to nip in off the seam and Lees was trapped in front for 45. Watling drove Marchant de Lange through point to bring up the 100 before the batsman sent the bowler to the fence twice more in de Lange's following over. Watling moved to his 50 soon after, and Burnham helped himself to two boundaries off a David Lloyd over. And Durham looked to have recovered well as tee approached with the score 140 for 3. But on the stroke of the interval, Burnham edged to Billy Root in the gully off Lloyd to leave Watling on his own on 60 not out at the break. Debutant Solomon Bell didn't last long after the tee break as he had his off stump uprooted by Michael Hogan for just one to leave Durham 5 down. Watling remained to take his side past 150 in partnership with Eckersley. But Glamorgan were able to claim their second bonus point as Hogan got one to jag back off the seam and pin Eckersley in front. Glamorgan would feel like they were in an excellent position if they could prize out Watling before the close, but he continued to hold the innings together for Durham as rain went on the attack with two boundaries off Van der Hoogten. The run rate slowed as the Durham 200 approached and the light began to fade, and an all-run 4 for rain off Carey proved to be the last scoring shot of the day as bad light ended play 9 overs early, with Durham 193 for 6 and Watling with an excellent 83 not out to his name. Watling completes deserved 100 before rain ends play at the Riverside. A combination of inclement weather and an excellent unbeaten 83 from Durham's new signing BJ Watling held up promotion chasing Glamorgan on day one at the Riverside. They'll hope to get amongst the wickets quickly on day two to keep their outside chance of promotion alive. And after a slightly delayed start, the visitors did just that, as Ben Rain played on to Marchant de Lange's third ball of the day. New batsman Bryden Cass went on the attack in response as four quick boundaries helped him bring up 17 off his first 12 balls and take Durham past 200 and to their first bonus point. A top edge over the keeper's head from a de Lange bumper took Cass to 26 before the big South African got his man in his next over as Cass had a waft outside off stump and edged through to the keeper. A 4 over the slips took Watling to 97 before he brought up a well-deserved century with a nudge to leg off Michael Hogan. But the rain duly arrived to bring about an early lunch, with Durham going well on 262 for 8. And that was that for the day in the end, as the rain set in with the umpires deciding no further play would be possible to deal Glamorgan's promotion hopes a further blow. Derbyshire shade day 3 at Lord's with Deploy and Hosin hitting 50s. Only 8.4 overs were possible on the second day of Middlesex versus Derbyshire because of heavy rain. Derbyshire managed to claim the wickets of Anderson and Simpson in the brief passage of play that was possible after lunch. Middlesex had moved on to 199 for 5 from their overnight 176 for 3 when play was called off at 4:15 yesterday. And on day 3, there was a short delay to the start of play, with the players coming out onto the field at 11:15. The floodlights on in the gloomy conditions, and before too long, Milan moved past the milestone of 1,000 county championship runs this season. But then the first wicket of the day would fall, Milan gone for 72 as he was trapped LBW by Rees. Harris and Roland Jones would both strike the ball to the ropes before the new ball was taken by Derbyshire. And the new ball did the trick, with the 7th and 8th wicket falling in quick succession. First, Roland Jones was trapped in front by Rees, and then the new batsman Miguel Cummins was bowled for a duck by Hudson Prentice. The 9th wicket arrived shortly after, with Bamber gone for a duck. And with one wicket still to secure, the umpires delayed taking the players off for lunch, and that gave Derbyshire time to claim that last wicket. Tim Murter trying to swing Hudson Prentice to leg and getting a leading edge to third slip. That was lunch, and Middlesex 260 all out had somewhat frittered away a promising position after reaching 155 for 2 yesterday. Milan top scoring with 72, Lewis Rees finishing with 4 for 61. Lewis Rees and Billy Goddaman would get the Derbyshire innings started, Goddaman needing 19 runs for 1,000 in the championship for the season. But with Derbyshire's score at 49 runs, two wickets would fall in the space of two balls. First, Rees was trapped LBW by Bamba for 26 runs. And the very next ball, Madsen was gone for a golden duck, again LBW. The next over brought another wicket, Goddaman the man to go, as Derbyshire's good start was being undone, Derbyshire 55 for 3. Shortly after reaching the Derbyshire 100, the fourth wicket arrived. An important breakthrough for Middlesex, Murta finding his 700th first-class wicket in a Middlesex shirt, as Hughes was caught by Cummins for 20. That brought tee, with Derbyshire 109 for 4. And Derbyshire would continue with their innings in the evening, with a good amount of play at the home of cricket today, a story that was not matched at many grounds across the country. The two batsmen were matching each other stride for stride, and it was looking like a race to see who would reach their half-century first. It was Hosin who won that race, his 50 coming off 80 balls. A few overs later, De Ploy would join his partner in moving past his 50, a very important partnership being built by these two. But sadly, play was brought to a close by bad light, with Derbyshire 199 for 4. Compared to several other grounds, it has been a feast of cricket at the home of cricket today. But after 74 overs of play, the umpires took the teams off as the light faded. And that was that for the day. Hosin and De Ploy have added 96 so far, and the visitors will resume on the final morning, 61 behind, with 6 wickets standing. Hardly any play possible on gloomy day at Lord's. Middlesex got the better of Derbyshire on a rain-affected first day in Division 2 of the County Championship at Lord's. Opener Sam Robson top-scored with 93 to help Middlesex close on 176 for 3, as stumps was called just before 5 p.m. with only 59 overs of play possible. On day two, the weather gods were in a bad mood, with rain meaning no play was possible throughout Tuesday morning. The players did get out onto the field just before 2 in the afternoon, with Milan resuming on 51 not out and 16 short of 1,000 championship runs for the season, Martin Anderson on 4. In theory, 59 overs left before stumps. In practice, it was looking unlikely we would get anywhere near that. And for Anderson, it was a positive start as he fired Hudson Prentice to the boundary. But just after that, he was sent on his way. Attempting to leave a Lewis Rees delivery, he got a thin edge through to the keeper. With the skies getting gloomy, another wicket would fall. John Simpson trapped LBW for 4 off the bowling of Dahl, Middlesex 199 for 5. But before long, the players were off once more on a frustrating day at Lord's. An early tee was taken, with the hope of conditions brightening up in the evening session. But sadly, that wasn't possible, and conditions got even worse. Fingers crossed that we get more play on day three of this contest. De Ploy completes his 100 before the inevitable draw at Lord's. De Ploy and Hosin both impressed for Derbyshire on day three, as they both scored half centuries as part of an unbeaten 96-run stand, after an Ethan Bamba burst for Middlesex reduced the visitors to 55 for 3. They'll resume on 199 for 4, with the draw almost a certainty on the final day. Play was able to begin at Lord's by the afternoon, and Derbyshire were immediately able to pass 200 and pick up their first bonus point, before Bamba continued his fine game by finding Hosin's edge, with Milan taking the catch at second slip. Critchley immediately got off the mark with a boundary, and the fours came in a steady stream for the next few overs. But bad light caused a brief interlude soon after, and when they returned, Bamba struck for the fourth time in the innings when Critchley top-edged a pull to Murta at mid-on. But De Ploy and new man Finn Hudson-Prentice were not deterred as they continued to share regular boundaries as Derbyshire moved past 250. Before Bamba had him edging behind to complete the first 5-wicket haul of the young seamer's career. The run rate slowed as Derbyshire moved into the lead, but a couple of streaky boundaries for De Ploy took his side to the brink of 300 and the batsman to 97. Tea came with Derbyshire 301 for 7, thanks to a pull round the corner from Dahl, and Deploy will hope to complete his century in the final session before the captains shake hands on the inevitable draw. After a brief delay for bad light, Deploy was able to complete his second championship century of the season as he cut Holden for 3. But immediately after, the rain arrived again at Lords and the draw was confirmed to bring an end to the season for both sides. They'll try again for promotion next season as Middlesex finish 8th with 133 points and Derbyshire finish one spot ahead with 145. Gloucestershire struggle with the bat before rain brings early end to day one. Gloucestershire play host to fellow promotion hopefuls Northamptonshire in what is the final and perhaps most important match of the season. With only 9 points needed to solidify promotion to Division 1, Gloucestershire will be hoping to avoid defeat to second place Northamptonshire, who are in a very similar position. A draw is likely to send them both up to Division 1 for 2020. With the toss uncontested, Northamptonshire elected to field first, and the Gloucestershire openers settled into the contest quickly, firing some early boundaries. But in the 10th over, the breakthrough came, as Bracey was caught by Rossington off the bowling of Sanderson, the opener gone for 8 runs. And the new batsman didn't last long, departing for 1 run off the bowling of Berg. The other opener was out soon after as well, direct hit from Luke Proctor, and Chris Dent was gone. That's the first bonus point for North Hants. The wickets kept tumbling. Roderick was the fourth wicket as he edged off the bowling of Sanderson, 60 championship wickets for Ben Sanderson this season. A freak dismissal would bring the fifth wicket, Charlesworth driving firmly down the ground, but Doug Bracewell getting a touch on it, and the non-striker Hankins was out of his ground, a real blow for Gloucestershire. And they were soon 6 down, Bracewell drifting into the leg stump, and Higgins clipping the ball straight to North Hants debutant Emilio Gay at square leg. Lunch would arrive, bringing a disappointing morning for Gloucestershire to an end, the hosts at 80 for 6. Just 2 balls were possible in the afternoon session before the rain arrived and it settled heavily in Bristol. No more play possible for the rest of the day. Sadly, the weather forecast has proved to be wholly accurate in this promotion clash, and it doesn't look great for tomorrow either. Just 2 more points needed for North Hants to move up to Division 1. Gloucestershire need 9. Gloucestershire make hay with the bat before Van Buren falls late in the day. Like much of the country, there was no play possible at Bristol on day 2, meaning they will hope to resume on day 3 with Gloucestershire 80 for 6 and Northamptonshire hoping to claim the 2 additional bonus points they need to guarantee promotion to Division 1 next season. Play belatedly began at 3 o'clock, with Van Buren picking up the first runs since before lunch on day 1 with a back foot drive through the covers. And Gloucestershire's solid start to the day continued as they passed 100 with another Van Buren 4. The pair found the boundary regularly as the partnership moved past 50. Another shower took the players off briefly, but the batsmen came back out looking to make up for lost time, as both batsmen sent Bracewell to the rope in the first over of the resumption, with Charlesworth moving to his 50 in the process. And the Gloucestershire pair were looking in complete control as regular boundaries took their side beyond 200. But with the overs ticking down to the close of play, Van Buren fell on the cusp of a first 100 of the season as he edged Berg behind to Rossington. The close of play arrived soon after with Gloucestershire 220 for 7, an excellent effort with the bat given they resumed on 80 for 6 in the afternoon. And both teams look set for promotion, with Glamorgan highly unlikely to force victory at Durham. Half centuries from Van Zyl and Rawlins help Sussex recover. After last week's defeat to Derbyshire ended their promotion bid, Sussex are playing for pride in their final County Championship Division 2 match of the season against Worcestershire at Hove. Worcestershire come into this match on the back of their narrow defeat in the weekend's Vitality Blast final. With an uncontested toss, Worcestershire elected to field first, and it looked to be a good decision as they struck with their third ball, Barnard the bowler, Wells out for a duck caught by Cox. and soon Sussex were two down. Haynes gone for a duck as well, Sussex 6-2. Van Zyl would steady the ship with some solid strokes to the boundary as Sussex looked to recover from their early wickets. But a third wicket fell soon after, Will Beer the man to go, caught by Cox off the bowling of Barnard. Rawlins would join Van Zyl in the middle and follow his lead as the boundaries came to help rectify the sticky situation for Sussex. The pairing would make it through to lunch with the score 81-3, Van Zyl unbeaten on 45 and Rawlins with him on 20. In the afternoon session, Van Zyl would move to his half century, a vital knock for Sussex after those early wickets. But he was soon to be the fourth wicket to fall, caught by Rutherford off the bowling of Morris for 56. Rawlins wasn't too far behind in celebrating his own half century. A few overs later, he was also gone though, Finch the bowler to strike as Rawlins was caught by Mitchell for 58, and with that, bad light arrived and tea was taken early. And shortly after that, the rain arrived, meaning no more play was possible for the rest of the day. Valuable runs from Rawlins and Van Zyl have helped out Sussex after the loss of early wickets, but more work to do with the bat tomorrow with a score at 150-5. Sussex pile on the runs as rain relents at Hove. Worcestershire made early inroads with the ball on day one before half centuries from Van Zyl and Rawlins helped them recover to 150-5 before rain curtailed the day. They'd have more work to do when play began on day two. The rain delayed play till after 3 o'clock, but when the teams eventually came out, Brown and Clark made a solid start for the hosts as they picked up some early boundaries. Brown cut Finch for 4 before picking up another boundary in the next over off Parnell. And the stand was nearing 50 when Clark's debut innings was brought to an end as he edged a loose shot off Parnell to Vessels at slip. And one wicket brought 2 as in the very next over Barnard pinned Brown in front. But Garton and Visa hit back with boundaries that took Sussex beyond the 200 mark. The batsmen went on the attack as the final session of the day began, with both Visa and Garton helping themselves to 4s off D'Oliveira. And the runs started to flow quite quickly as Garton went on the attack to take the partnership past 50. A Visa cut for 4 off Morris was followed up 2 balls later with a pull to the fence, but with the very next delivery the bowler got his man with an in-swinger that ripped out his leg stump. Garton responded with 2 powerful boundaries in the following over from Barnard to take him past 50. But the umpires then decided the lights had deteriorated and took the players off, bringing play to the close with the score 299-8 after an excellent afternoon's batting from Sussex.